breakup, it is a lot more painful. When you have sex with someone, part of you stays with that person and vice versa. You know, it's never a clean break. It's never, you know, an easy split. So you just want to think about these things. And Jeremiah's going to do a math problem with you here in health class.
Should be pretty simple, though. That story might sound like drastic, like thank God it doesn't happen every day, but since I've been presenting with New Hope for just over 5 years, since I started presenting in Central New York, I've heard that story, not that I haven't heard that story, I've seen that story play out 3 different times in our area. So it's not so crazy uncommon, it never happens, thankfully it doesn't happen a lot, but it's tragic that it does. So 1 plus 1 equals 13. And what I want to talk to you about is this idea that, have you ever heard this? When you have sex with somebody, you're having sex with everybody they've ever had sex with.
Yeah.
Somebody ever, there's a commercial that came out a couple years ago. I think it actually aired for the first time during a Super Bowl, where there was 2 people in bed, and the doors to the bedroom opened up, and then like 50 people filed in, all with white t-shirts on, but each of them had a name of an STD across their chest. It was that, it was to illustrate this idea that like, there's just 2 people in bed, but all these other people with their donated STDs could be also present in that one sexual encounter. So I'm going to show you how that plays out in a little story form. I'm not an artist, so I'm just going to go ahead and use some stick figures. So track with me here. I'm going to show you how one person having sex with one person could actually be 13 different donors to that one sexual encounter. Okay. And remember, whenever we're talking about sex, we're talking about any genital contact of any kind. Okay. So this girl here, she's got long brown hair. She's wicked good with a bow and arrow. She was in something called the Thirsty Games. What's her name?
Katniss.
Katniss, right. I'm just checking to see if they're paying attention. I know it's the Hunger Games. I'm just wondering if you're listening. All right, so her, the thing about her is, at the beginning of our story, she's a virgin. That means she's never had sex with anybody. She moves on to this dude here. He's like, Katniss, babe, you must be tired because you've been running through my mind all day. He's the son of a baby. He's from the Hunger Games. What's his name?
Peeta.
Peeta. And Peeta is like, he's got, just for the sake of our story, he has had sex with 2 different people before having sex with Katniss. And because of that, he has a couple of STDs. What should we give him?
Herpes.
How about gonorrhea?
Her, got her gonorrhea first. All right. So she's like, oh, I've been running through your mind all day. I love you. Let's have sex. So they do. When they do, how many people could she contract STDs from?
3.
We're going to put that number down here. Just to clarify, because this is the hardest math you're going to do the whole time, right? There's 2 up here plus him. For her, that's 3 people that she could potentially contract STDs from. We're going to put that number down here. All right? So how many STDs could she get?
3.
The 2 that we mentioned, and then any others that we don't know about. Alright, so all of them. We'll just say all of them, right? And the same is true for him at this point. We know she's a virgin here, but not necessarily is that privileged information to him. They break up, which I know not many teenage relationships do break up, but in this case they do. sorry. so he was, some of you were like, stop it! I loved him! So this girl here, this is a little bit different. She's got like this crazy crown thing going on across her forehead. She's got this golden rope that she uses to make people tell the truth. What's her name? Like, loud?
Wonder Woman.
Yeah, Princess Diana. So Peeta's like, yo, babe, your dad must have been a thief because he stole the stars and he put them in your eyes. She's like, oh, that's so sweet. Let's have sex. So they do. But before that, you need to know that she has had sex with 2 people before meeting up with Peeta. And because of the 2 plus Peeta plus his 3, what does that make?
6.
6, right? Very good. So how many of the STDs could she get?
6. All of them.
All of them, right? The 2 that we've mentioned, and then any others that are in that mix. Maybe people don't know they don't have any symptoms. So they don't even know they have them yet, but they're there and they're present in those 6 people. So they break up, sadly. All the people we're talking about right now, use your imaginations to think of them as teenagers. And just so you know, in your teen years, you guys are super strong. I know you're super strong because you're Beagle students. But you're not quite as strong as you will be in your early 20s. Until then, your immune system is still developing. That means you're more susceptible to bacteria, viruses, things like that. Also, these guys, once they come in contact or they get an STD, they're more susceptible to a second, a third, and a fourth, because their immune system's already fighting on one front. It's like a war. You get attacked on a second front, you have less resources to fight that attack off, right? So if someone has one STD, their immune system is depleted even more so, and they're unable to fight off those other sicknesses that come along. All right, so Wonder Woman breaks it off with Beta, because, you know, he heads off to the Hunger Games with Katniss again. And she needs a guy with a little bit more magic. So this guy comes along with some dark glasses, a lightning bolt scar on his forehead, a magic wand.
Wait, let me do a
What's his name?
This is what you
Smarty fan fiction.
No, not Harry.
So Harry Potter has had sex with two people before meeting up with Wonder Woman. And as a result... Listen, he's magical, but you can't get rid of these STDs. What are they?
AIDS.
Oh, he's giving him AIDS.
AIDS. What else should we give him?
HIV is the same thing.
Alright. So he's got HIV syphilis. They have sex. How many people could he contract AIDS from at this point in his life?
12?
Not 12.
13.
Oh. Nine. You see where that's coming from?
That was easy. I'm not right.
How are you?
What's your name?
Christoph.
Christoph? Oh, I like that name. I really like that hoodie. That color green is really my favorite color green. You know what? Would you like to go out on a date?
Sure.
You know, I think you are the one. I think, Christoph, you and I are going to be together forever. Okay? I have this gift that I've been saving my whole life. I've never given it away to anyone. But I really want you to have it because I think you're the one.
Go ahead and open it. Okay.
Thank you.
I'm like this.
That's what you've been holding up your whole life. I think we should start questioning.
We're not done. Okay. Hi.
Hi.
What's your name?
John.
It's John. Thanks. I'm Diane.
Nice to meet you.
I love your sweatshirt.
Thank you.
ACC is the best conference out there, isn't it?
Yeah.
You know, I'm psyched that you have that on.
Thank you.
You know, would you like to go out on a date?
Yes.
Because I think you're the one. I think you and I are going to be together forever. All right?
Yeah.
Okay. I have a little unfinished business to take care of. Can you wait right here?
Yeah.
Okay, great. Christoph, said that you and I were going to be together forever, and that you're the one. But I just met this guy that has an ACC conference hoodie on, and he's the one. Okay? So I know I gave you that gift, but I kind of need it back. Can you get it back?
Plot twist.
Plot twist.
John, you know, I really think you and I are going to be together forever. And I had this gift that I was saving, but then I kind of didn't. I kind of gave it away. But I want you to have it now, okay? Because I think you're the one.
Unless
I see the money. No.
$10. All right, I wouldn't let you do it. But what did this gift represent when I gave it to Christoph?
As a dream.
Virginity.
Virginity. Yes. It wasn't quite the same when this gift was given to John, was it?
No, it was you.
It's gone, bro.
Right. And we're not saying that sex is like a gum, or that someone has sex is like a piece of sugar. We are just saying that as casually as I just treated this is how casually some people approach sex. You know what? It really is a big deal. And truly, you can only give your virginity away once, okay? Now, I think that Christoph and John both deserve a round of applause for their acting skills. Unchewed gum.
Thank you.
Sorry. So we're gonna change things up a little bit and ask you to think of the topic in a little bit of a different way than you've been talking about.
Sorry.
Damn. That hit me.
Sex is kind of a relationship like that can have lots of emotional benefits, physical benefits, and, you know, as you can tell, societal benefits. So what else? What other advantages would they have? Think about what we talked about yesterday as disadvantages. Flip those on their head. Yeah.
Oh, I was going to say one more thing. She has a kid, you know, with chores.
Right? So in other words, two-parent home.
What's that show?
Right? Yeah. And what you're saying, what if you rewind that a little bit, you go back to the teen years of those people, you'd say there's no chance of teenage pregnancy. Right? There's no wondering if that kid's yours or if that kid's not yours.
Yeah.
Mom or dad. So there's a lack, like, is there less stress?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So less stress involved.
Emotionally.
Emotional stress. And especially, like, if you're thinking of, if you contract an STD, there's not just emotional stress, there's physical stress. The damage done to the physical body. So yesterday we talked a little bit about the dropout rate among teen moms is pretty high. So what's the opposite of that? What's the advantage?
You don't have to drop out of school. You can finish school,
you
get a job.
Finish school. So you have a higher probability of a higher education in that case. So they have a higher chance. Doesn't mean they will for sure go on to college, but it's saying they have the advantage, right? They would have the advantage. Assuming they aren't in college.
Or they are in college, or they aren't. Like, if they are in college, they will drop out, or if they are. Like, if they aren't, they will drop out, or something like that.
Gotcha. So, like, if they're not having sex until they would get married, if they waited to get married until after they were out of college, then they have a higher chance of completing both high school, college, and going on to then what? After college?
Jobs.
Job. Not just a job, like, that they have to work.
A profession?
Yeah, profession, a career. Something they've been trained for, right? Which ends up giving you more
dough,
right? Which solves all your problems, right?
Yes.
Yeah. No. Talk to TMZ for a few minutes. You'll realize there's a lot of rich people with big problems. But it does give you cash to buy diapers, formula, cribs, furniture, cute little onesies that your wife makes you buy that match with your shirt. Oh my God. Never mind. Oh, that's a whole different problem. What else? What else? Other advantages? Anything else? What are we missing? What are you guys going to do when you get home today?
Play some basketball,
whatever you need to do. You're going to do all of that because what do you have? What do you have?
Life.
Time, money, you have your family you can hang out with, all of which kind of drifts away in terms of time, money, and sometimes support if you got to pick up Junior from daycare, right? Like, life's a whole lot less free to live when you've got to take care of a child. Just, you know, ask Mrs. Gates. She's got a few that she's got to always be watching, right? So freedom. You have more free time, more freedom to do and be a teenager in the midst of your journey, right? Anything else? This is a great list. We're not going to spend too much time here, but some others have said friends. It starts out with friendship and then leads to healthy, clear communication, which builds trust. That creates a choice to love someone that then leads to a deep level of respect that all snowballs into this decision to stay with that person for your life. And then put that sex into this equation and it brings fulfillment, joy, long-lasting connection. Now, all of that, notice down here that we put sex with vanilla. Anybody ever had vanilla by itself?
It smells fantastic, right?
Some senses it seems amazing, but then when you put it in your mouth, it's like, oh my gosh, what did I do? Well, the same thing's true of sex. Inside the right ingredient base can be fantastic. Outside of that, it can be really So just bear that in mind. By the way, the cookies you're eating right now, none of them have vanilla in them, and they're still pretty good, right?
Yeah,
you can have great relationships with people. Just like you guys said yesterday, you can be great friends with somebody. You can trust somebody strongly. You can respect somebody huge and not be having sex with them. Right? There's great relationships you can have and not be physical. We're not here to tell you sex is bad. That would be a lie. Sex is great within that committed relationship we call marriage. That's where it can be the safest. Not only physically, but emotionally. Outside of that, it can be destructive. Think of fire in the fireplace. Awesome. In the middle of your living room or your bedroom, not so awesome anymore, right? Like, destruction happens. So inside those healthy boundaries, it can be really great. And is. So So developing refusal skills is what we're going to talk about for the next few minutes. Saying no at the time you need to say no is what's going to preserve the space and the place of your life that you want, right? You're all making decisions about this topic. We're, you know, it's no new news that you're thinking about and making decisions about sex and relationships. For you, the question is, how are you going to say no at the point where you've decided to say no? Don't wait until you get into the scenario to make that decision. It's not going to be easy, but you can. You have the control, and you can resist the pressure. There's all kinds of people in this world trying to tell you what you should or shouldn't do with your body, but you're the only one with it. You're the one that's been given dominance over it. We want to encourage you to think about what you're going to do in that moment. Create a mental pathway for yourself to know, well, when I'm in that scenario, this is where I say no, no further. So that means deciding ahead of time who you're going to date. How do those people find access to your life? Are you allowing people in your life that you don't know through an app on your phone? If so, you need to make real sure you know who that person is before you give them any personal information, right? You all know the term catfish. It seems like there's a new app every day coming out for people to connect. Last year right now, about this space of time, the hot topic was House Party, right? That was a big app. And now it's drifted off, and there's other ones taking its place, and I promise next year there'll be a new one, and we'll all be using different things. Well, date rape usually happens among acquaintances. It's not complete strangers that take advantage of people as much as it is people that kind of know each other. Because you get that sense, people get that sense of like false security, and then they let themselves be taken advantage of, or they get into a situation where they lose their safety blanket. All right, so this should be all review. By the time you're in 10th grade at Baker, this should all be stuff you've heard before, but I'll say it again. Never post anything online that you wouldn't want on the cover of a magazine. Once you post it, it's out there forever. Remember, everyone has a floor button. Well, the last couple years ago, we all found that out when Snapchat went to court and they were sued and lost because they were saving all of everybody's pictures on a server, and then they got hacked, and all those pictures went out. People were like, wait, so it doesn't disappear after 3 seconds?
No,
it doesn't. All right. Anybody with a little bit of technical skill can get at it. So decide ahead of time when you're going to date. Statistics show that the sooner you begin dating, the sooner you begin having sex. And that means age-wise. The younger you are when you begin dating, the younger you are when you begin having sex. That doesn't mean that every kid who started dating at 10 years old is absolutely having sex as a teenager. That's not what that means. It just means, statistically speaking, people who started dating younger began having sex sooner, statistically, right? How are you going to date? Are drugs and alcohol going to be part of that picture? We had a young man coming out of Central New York. He was a great baseball player. He was an MVP of his team. He had a full ride to a Division I school. And in his senior year, towards the end of the year, he wanted to celebrate with his buddies. They went to a party. He got drunk and had a one-night stand with a girl. Had sex with her one time. 3 months later, guess what phone call he got from her?
I'm pregnant.
He's pregnant. Now, he had a decision to make. Is he going to go off to college, take that scholarship, or is he going to stay home and try to handle things from there? Either way, he's got a decision to make. Now, he decided to stay home and try to take care of that baby locally. Now, does it mean he can't ever achieve those goals and dreams? No. But it's going to be a whole heck of a lot harder trying to do it as a dad than it would have been otherwise. So you can learn from this story. I don't know what he would say. If he was here and I said, hey, what would you do different? I don't know what he would say. But you can look at the story and go, what am I going to do different because I'm hearing this? Where will we go? You know, it's a whole lot easier to keep your clothes on in the food court of the mall than it is in the basement of your grandma's house on a couch with some soft music playing. Don't ask me why I picked your grandma's house. I just did. What will we do? Avoid unplanned time, right? If a person is worth spending time with and building a relationship with, they're worth setting up a plan to make them feel special for, right? Like, think about what you're going to do with that person. Honor them enough to actually find out what they would like to do, and then set a schedule. Because the people that love them want to know where they're going to be and what they're going to be doing. And if you love them, you will respect them enough. If you care for them, you'll respect them enough to respect the people that care for them. Does that make sense? So if you're somebody who's going out with a person, ask them, hey, what's the plan? What are we going to do? When should I be home? When can I tell my parents or my grandparents or whoever it is that's looking after you that I'm going to be home? And then communicate that to them. So just in the odd chance that that person you're going out with ends up being a psycho, they know where you're supposed to be and when you're supposed to be there. So if you go off the map, they can find the last most relevant place that you were, okay? Important stuff that helps you say no at the right time. If you say to somebody, hey, what are we gonna do? And they go, oh, it doesn't matter, I'll figure it out. A red flag should go up because they're trying not to tell you what they're gonna be doing. Unless they're like, you know them for a long time, it's your birthday, like, oh, I can't really tell you. Maybe it's a surprise party. So then just start asking around to more people and figure it out before they don't be surprised. That's just my way. I don't like being surprised. So there was a girl in a class like this who said, I was out with a guy, first time we went to a movie, we were walking out, and I asked him, you know, what are we going to do next? And he said to her, oh, I don't know, we can figure it out, we'll go somewhere. And she said to him, no, I'm not leaving the rest of my night up to your imagination. And she had a plan worked out where if she ever felt uncomfortable on a date, she could call her dad immediately, and he would pick her up right where she was. So she did so. He picked her up right there. Date was over. Keep your location services on and let people know where you're supposed to be. All right? Common sense stuff in 2017. There's a lot of ways to avoid danger. All right? Say no. Saying no in the right time can help you avoid a lot of unplanned activity. All right? Here's a little graphic to help you understand where you might want to draw the no line. I don't know where that's going to be for you, but you can draw it in here. Let's say it's holding hands or casual kissing, and you say to somebody, hey, just so you know when you're talking, just so you know, I'm not into anything. Like, I'm not into anything other than, like, don't even try to do anything below my neck. Just don't even try it. Or don't even try to do anything besides hold my hand. Whatever. However you're going to say no and have that conversation, just say it. If that person responds with, what, are you serious? Are you kidding? Well, then you know right away, they're not trying to protect what you value. They're trying to take something from you and pull you farther to the right, right? So it's a good tool to communicate well with and to make sure you're on the same page with somebody. So be it. Somebody's farther on the right, great, but that's not the match for you. If you have already drawn your line, that's enough. And you can have that open conversation early on before you're in the basement of your grandma's house, all right? Which you shouldn't be anyway, go to the food court. All right? It's freedom to do whatever you want to do, whenever you want to do it. What do you think? Do whatever you want to do, whenever you want to do it.
No.
I would submit to you that freedom is living within healthy boundaries. Anybody want to be a licensed driver in the future at some point? Anybody a licensed driver right now? Let's say you get your license, you're blessed enough to get a Baker High School parking permit, and you're leaving school, and you're like, man, I just want to get home. You're like, forget these buses. You fly around 18,000 buses in the parking lot. Pull up on the sidewalk. There's a little grandma out there walking her dog. Boom, boom. You drive over top of them. You're like, I want to get home. Xbox. You fly through some red lights. You get home. Who's going to be waiting for you at your house?
Nobody.
The police.
Somebody's going to be there by the time you get there. And they're going to have a badge and a gun and handcuffs. And what they're going to do is they're going to take away this. Right? Because you thought you had this, but what you really never had in the first place was it. Because freedom is found with a driver's license by living within the healthy boundaries of the road. Right? We all agree upon a rule of law, and we live within those, and it enables us to be free to drive. So freedom in sex and relationships is about deciding ahead of time what are those rules and boundaries going to be, and then living within those for the fullest version of freedom that you can live in. All right? So be free.
I was on $20.
I don't like it. I'm right here.
Who would still want it? Why do you still want it?
Because
$20.
The value of it is $20 no matter what you're doing.
It's the same thing.
It's still worth $20, right? And this $20 bill reminds me a little bit of you guys, and let me tell you why. No matter what decisions you've made in the past, no matter what decisions you may make in the future, or even if a decision was taken away from you and you were a victim like Jeremiah spoke about yesterday, you are still valuable. There is nothing that can change your value. You are valuable from the moment you were conceived, and you will be valuable forever. And we as adults don't tell you enough just how valuable you are. And want you to know that your value does not depend on what you look like, what you wear, what you have, what you don't have, what you've done, or what you will do. Your value cannot, does not, and will not change. Okay, Jeremiah's going to pass out to you a survey. And before he hands them out, I just want to say, do not put your names on them. It's completely anonymous. Your teachers won't see them. Nobody in Baker High School is going to see them. The only people that are going to see these are the people that administer this program.
Oh, yeah.
And we do it to improve the program, improve the presentation. So please don't put your names.